All right, welcome to the College of Complexes, everybody. My name is Don, and I'm going to be the moderator this evening. Can I have your attention, please? Andy, welcome to the College of Complexes. Now, our program tonight is a very timely program because our speaker tonight is college regular Li-Ping Yuan, and the topic of his lecture tonight is fixing the worst part of the political system, the legislative branches. Now, warm round of applause for our speaker tonight, Li-Ping Yuan.
Thank you.
Excuse me.
Yeah, I'm glad to show up here and give a presentation, which is encouraged by Steve. I'd like to thanks to Steve. He gave a talk about to get rid of all the incumbents. It's apparently it's hard to do because they got re-elected all the time. But then I'm trying to say some thoughts I have to how to overcome that, how to fix the problem. Not completely fix, but make improvements. So this legislative branches is among the three branches of the political system. I think everybody agrees that has the biggest problem. Some of the problems everybody knows, just quickly go through them. Lowest approval rating. Everybody doesn't like it, but for some reason they got re-elected over and over again. And the result is it's an organization heavily controlled by money, okay? Because they want to be re-elected to get a good pension, good salaries, and get the power. So they are. They need money, and the money is provided by special interest group and big corporations like NRA or ALEC. And NRA is not too bad, I think, because they not only talk to the legislators, but they also talk to people, get some people's support, and then that's at least they talk to people, but like organization ALEC, it's not talk to people at all. It's just connecting the big corporations and try to make the laws favor corporation, probably against people. So they are a kind of secret organization. I think that's very bad. They try to bypass or hide from people and voters. Why this happening? Why is this happening? Because I think just less news coverage, less attention, less scrutiny on the lawmakers, because there are so many of them compared to, say, president, governors, or mayors. It's just too many people to keep chasing them. And you chase one, it's not enough. Only a small district is interested in that person, but all the other districts are not interested in particular lawmaker. So it's hard to news to cover that, and just the system is built up like that. From a voter point of view, we just don't have enough time to know all the lawmakers because they don't cover in the news, okay? And we have to actively to dig to know the lawmakers and know what they do, what they have done in the past. So it's just a difficult job. Maybe I can take a survey for all of you, see if you read 10 news articles about president election, like Donald Trump, Hillary Clinton, or Sanders, Bernie Sanders. If you read 10 articles of them, do you compare relatively read one article on your congressman election? I don't know if you have more than that. Probably not. Everybody just look at the president, and then for the most of the time when you go to the vote, you just vote by party lines. Okay, you don't really know what the candidate is, what they're proposing, because they will follow the party lines. So they create a very strong partisan organization in the assembly, and the strong partisan basically lost the meaning of have a meeting. Okay, meeting is a negotiation and a communication, but if strong partisans there, they just fight to each other. There's no communication at all. There's no compromise. There's no moderates there, and there's no voice between the two other than the two major parties. So it's a very difficult situation, and the last reason I think is gerrymandering, and that's the system created. So there's such a thing called gerrymandering, and a little bit more about it, just an example. In 2014 House representative elections in Pennsylvania, a Democrat got 44% of the vote, but in terms of the seats, they got only 27%. In North Carolina, it's even worse. The Democrat got 44% of the vote, but only 23% of the seats.
Wow.
So it's really not balanced. And overall, nationwide, the Democrat got more than half of the votes, 51% of the votes, but they got only 46% of the seats. That's why they lost the House, and the House is under the control of the Republican. And this just not anything agree with the Democratic principles. Okay, so it's a very bad bad thing because of the gerrymandering. And this is about the results of overview, but when we come back to a personal level as a voter, when I want to vote, the election season is coming, I want to vote, and what I'm facing, everybody is facing, is there's no good candidates there. Usually candidates, only a handful of candidates at most. And if usually most of the time only two or two major parties. Sometimes only one major party even doesn't have a candidate. So there's no good choice. And even if there are choices like five or six candidates there, it's hard to find one candidate fully agree with me, my opinion, or mostly agree with my opinion. It's just, it's hard to find. If I'm lucky, or someone is lucky, I do find a pretty decent candidate, but if it's not one of the two parties, major parties, what can I do? Like a Green Party, I like to vote for Green Party. I like to be environmentalist. Probably, if I would vote for Green Party candidates, and then my vote will be totally waste because they just don't get elected.
Right.
The chances are very, very high they don't get elected.
Absolutely.
So, if for example, if I'm lucky enough, I do see some good candidates, but for some reason, my district is heavily, I don't know if this is an English word or not, gerrymanderized. It's heavily controlled, being processed, the districting. The outcome is already on the wall. It's already there. Who is going to be elected? It's already determined. Everybody pretty much knows that. Why do I bother to vote whether I like the candidate or not? So that's, yeah, it's a very strong discouragement. And if I did find a good candidate and vote for them, and he is one of the two parties, and there's a chance he or she will win, and voted, but eventually he or she lost the election, then my voice again got kicked out or disappeared. So for all these cases, basically, I don't have, my effort is totally wasted. There's no voice at all at the end. Okay, if in some cases my candidate did get elected, he goes to Washington, D.C. or Springfield or City Hall and do his job. But the problem is now he's surrounded by lobbyists, surrounded by interest groups, and then they have to party line to follow. So where is his promises? I don't know whether you, and how about your voices? Probably got lost somewhere mostly. And so that's one of the major reasons the turnout is very low for midterm elections, because people just feel there's no good reason to go to vote. This is a system problem. It's not particular person. It's not people's problem. It's not a candidate or bad, or a representative is bad, or our vote is bad. The citizen is bad. No, it's not. It's a problem of the system. The system was designed 100 years ago, 200 years ago. Maybe some parts of the system was designed 300. Almost 300 years already. They just cannot keep up with the modern technologies. Many the new complaints. Right now, everybody is complaining, dissatisfaction. If you listen to what Trump is talking about, you just say, oh, the dissatisfaction is really overwhelming in the society. Everybody is discussed with the incumbents. So see, there's a big sign there, stop the incumbents on my team's t-shirt.
Right.
But if you look at why it's happening, it's because the internet, you've got so much negative information. If the politician did something good, probably they don't get much news coverage. But if they did something bad or something got hurt because of the policy, and the news will be very big, and everybody excited, energized to complain, to protest. And otherwise, they don't have a way to release their energy, to release their anger. Supposedly, the election should be a way for them to release their anger, to put things in terms of action, okay? To elect the person they want to express their opinions. But for the above, all the reasons, people just don't have a good choice during the election. So I think that's the problem with all this internet, so much negative information, and there's no way to guide those energy, those anger into the proper systems we are trying to use, we are using for the democratic system. So here I'm just suggesting two improvements. Quite simple. One is add online meeting and voting for all the candidates, or for most of the candidates. Okay, if you want to be a representative, if you got support from people, at least one from yourself probably, and then you should be go to the assembly meeting, even remotely, and vote on legislature, on legislatures, on bills. So your voice will be carried to each bill. Okay. The second is, of course, then the voting method may be changed. The votes should be weighted by the election votes. If you got more election votes, then you become a big, important representative than other, compared to other representatives who got only a few votes. Okay. So two things. One is have the online meeting and the voting. So more representative can get through the channel to represent all the voters. Basically, all the voters will have representative for each bill. Okay. Then the second is the modernize the voting methods. A little bit more about the meeting. Okay. The current system is whatever you got the highest vote in that district, then go to the DC or go to Springfield, you have an office and you have staff and you can stay there and do your thing. It's still there, okay, still keep that. You also, I called it on-site representative, okay. It's a current system, we don't change that much. But we add this online or remote representatives. They can do at home. Just listen to the meeting and give their votes, okay? They may not do many other things, I'll mention that later, but at least they can vote on each bill. That's most important job for a representative. For this remote representative, probably at the beginning we don't want to make a dramatic change. Suddenly there are thousands of representatives and then people may just get confused. We may want to have a cutoff, say if you elected by more than 100 votes, then you can be representative, or you can elected by more than 10 votes, you can be a representative. But eventually, this is just an artificial cutoff. Eventually, you probably want to remove the cutoff limit. So every people, every candidate can go to the assembly meeting to vote on the bill, okay? The second, how they get paid? They probably get paid by the number of votes that they received during the election. Because if you are an important person representative, you should pay more, then you can hire staff and do a better job. If you are just represent yourself, then you have to really put a lot of effort and with a minimum payment, but if you want to do that, certainly nobody shouldn't be discouraged. So, and there are other details like when the remote representative they join the meeting, they can listen, of course, but do they allow to speak? That would be a major job to schedule thousands of people to speak at the meeting. So probably not. But they should be allowed to post some messages to voice on the website and for some discussions and formal official discussions. And I think those are possible, quite possible. They can post the question and answers online. About if you do some further activities for remote representatives, can they introduce bills? okay, they joined committees or subcommittees, or can they hold a hearing? Right now, probably it's hard to imagine those things, but in the future, if you can do a remote meeting, then this may be able to get done. So those are all possibilities, but we don't really restrict them, the possibility, or said they have to do this, but it's just some options. So basically, whatever the rules for the house rules or operation rules, whatever is practical or makes sense, and is decided by that group of representatives anyway. That's the current practice. So every assembly get together first time, they pass their house rules. This will be part of the house rules, they whatever they want to do. So this is about remote representatives. It's new. How about the votes at the meetings? The votes, the representatives, they vote, should be weighted by the election votes. This is easier for the elections districted by populations. For example, the U.S. House, the House districts are based on the population. They change every 10 years. And also Illinois Senate and the House are also based on the population, how they district. And also city councils, at least the Chicago City, I think it's like that. And the Naperville, there's no district. It's just a big pool, and they elect 7 or 9 council members. But all this based on populations can use this method. The meeting votes are weighted by their election votes received, okay? And this rule should be applied to both on-site representatives and the remote representatives. So one person got 10,000 votes, their vote will be 10,000 weight, and the other person got 200 votes at the election, their vote will have 2,000 weight, and then you add them up for pros and cons for each bill, and then see how the bill pass or reject. Probably no more roll calls. Okay, right now lots of small meetings they use roll calls, like in the city council or Naperville council, they have roll calls, but that's just won't be practical anymore. We need a computerized system with internet. Okay, but this is not very difficult. All this process are public. There's no secret ballot. There's nothing to hide. It's all public. All the representatives, they put their votes. They are all. We should all know them, and they should be published. So, really, shouldn't have any concern about they have been altered, because every representative they can verify their own votes. Okay. And once the table, all the numbers got in and add together, it's I think the organization, the administrator for that assembly meeting should add them a few more times, make sure everything add correctly. And also all the generalists and research organization, there are lots of researchers, they want this kind of detailed data to analyze in depth about everything. So those numbers will be scrutinized in depth. So there's no problem about the security or inaccuracy. Some, maybe you think an internet attack, it may be an important bill will be voted, and then China or Russia, they try to attack the the voting process, to stop the voting. That's possible, but that those kind of actions won't be hidden. Everybody would know that. Oh, my system doesn't work. Okay. Then the system can be fixed to prevent those attacks, and then the vote will continue. The legislative business, basically, it's not, there's no emergency. Postponed a couple of days, and then nothing will. Right now, the Illinois the budget has been dropped for months, and people not killed, not being killed. It's not like 911 system. If you system broke for a couple hours, people will get killed. So the system should be no concern about the security, and it should work eventually. If there's a problem, it will work, be fixed. Just like right now, if there's an assembly meeting in the room, if the lights went out, then the meeting won't be continued after the lights fixed. This will be the same. The internet went out, it will be fixed, and then the meeting can continue. Okay. So this is about the internet usage we can use for the improvement. So the result of these two improvements, we have a fair system. Every vote are equally representative. Okay. Every representative have different weights. Some are more important than the other, but in terms of voters, all the voters will be equally represented, will be representative. That's the first thing. The second thing, they are equally representative. And then the voters' feeling is, okay, I go to the election, I vote my representatives, not voting for district representatives. Right now, we all vote just for district representative. We just vote for one person to come out. But with this modification, I vote my representative. Okay, it will be there, it will be at the meeting, it will voice my concern.
Is this like proportional voting?
Andy, Q&A is after the lecture, okay? Andy, save it for the Q&A.
Okay, yeah, this is like proportional voting. It's being weighted by your election votes. And also, the voter will have more choices because the candidate won't last totally, won't get disappointed, will lose completely. So all the candidates, at least you can get your own votes and maybe a few of your friends and the relatives. And so people will be more willing to be a candidate and then to be a representative. And then the outcome is voters have more choices to vote. They can see which one really have in common with my opinion. Then the result is much higher turnout rate. Right now the midterm election is very sad, okay, 20%, 30%. And with this encourages and the practical ways for voters, and the turnout should be much higher. Maybe you can say things are not so easy. One thing in this system is people, the voters, have to spend more effort to know more candidates and to know them better, okay? But I think it's good, it's worthwhile. Every voter try to understand what the government is doing, what the problem they have, and what the candidates can propose different solutions. And then they know the candidates, and then they can vote for one candidate which agrees with the voter. And I think it's worthwhile effort, and it's good for the society because the citizen wants to know more about the government, wants to know about their representative, and the government certainly will have a good communication with the citizens. It's also good for representatives. Okay? It's fair for a representative. If you win the election, you are not take everything. You win, but not take everything. If you lose, you don't lose everything. Okay? The current system is the winner take all, the loser get nothing. Okay? This system, the winner get what you earn for, the loser get what you earn for, and then still you are not completely lost. And also easy to be a representative. Okay? If you are interested, you have time, you want to put the effort, you want to get started, to get involved in the politics for the society, you can get an easy start. You don't be afraid of a failure. Okay. Other advantages? One big one, no more gerrymandering. Gerrymandering is just basically useless under this system because there are so many representatives, all the voice will be represented. You do the districting any way you want. Everybody still being representative. The districting is only to make sure the elected representatives are local. Okay, it's not just all the popular star, movie star, or sport players, and then they are not local or. So local representatives, you need to put a district there. And then no big winners or big losers at the election. Okay, so I think the election will be not that competitive. Okay, and so probably less money involved and for the election. And the less partisan and the more on issues, because at the assembly meeting, there are opinions from all sides, all directions. It's not just two parties. Okay, so less partisan and more on the issues to address. And because of large number of representatives, okay, it's harder for lobbyists and for special interest group to be effective. Right now, you can probably make a phone call to a few representatives and invite them for lunch to a fancy restaurant and get things settled. But in the future, with this improvement, there are so many representatives out there and so much votes out there, it's hard to get a hold of control. Especially for the remote ones. Okay, earlier we talked about the voting method for elections based on the population, but some are not based on the population. Okay, like U.S. Senate, it's every state has two seats. Okay, and the election is one at a time. Those two seats were not completely overlapped. Okay? They staggered each other. So this system, the votes will be a little bit more involved if you don't completely understand. I try my best to explain, but if you don't completely understand, you just know there's a way to get around of that. It's the meeting votes are weighted by the fraction of the election votes against the total votes of that district. For example, in Illinois, Dick Durbin now has one vote in the Senate meeting. If for this future system, if Big Durbin got 60% of the total election votes, so his vote will be multiplied by 0.6, that's 60%. And if you, then there are more other smaller, less important representatives. Those ways all add together will be one. Will be one, because for that election year, for that district, for Illinois, there's only one seat for Senate. And so this is, the result will be comparable to the current system. Okay, if you have a question about this, we can talk about later. So basically, what I try to say is that there, I just propose two improvements. One is add online meeting and voting for the organization, for the assembly. The second is meeting votes, voting method should be changed. The meeting votes should be weighted by the election votes, so it's proportional. And the some good advantage is every vote will be counted. Every voter's voice will be counted. It's a fair system for voters and equal representative for voters. Okay. And there's no, will be no gerrymandering. Just no way to the gerrymandering will work. And probably less on partisan, maybe still partisan, because people like to group, get grouped, and support each other to form a big party. But will be less on that. There'll be more parties, or and the party will be not that important. And more on issues, more on topics. And less on election attacks. During the election, you probably just want to promote yourself instead of target the next possible candidate. Oh, okay. Right now, everybody is targeting, if I'm not the highest candidate, I'm targeting the highest candidate. Everybody wants to drag him down. And the highest candidates try to target the second one and try to distance from him. So, but in the future, if you try to target another person, probably the thing is you will be looked down. It will hurt the other person and hurt yourself also, because there are so many candidates. You are not electing only one. Okay, you are electing all the representatives. So if you do negative attack, that just shows your bad personalities, and the many people doesn't like that. So less attacks and the spending, okay, and the less lobbying and the money control, okay. It will be mostly controlled by the voters' voice. And I think best of all is all citizens will be more interested in the system, into the voting, and if they got really excited, they can be the representative to represent themselves truly and with some other people's thinking the same. Okay. So at the end, for today's talk, I want to keep remember is there are two possible improvements for our legislative system. One is adding online meeting and voting to include all the voice, to have more representatives at the assembly meeting. And then the meeting votes should be weighted by election votes, so it's a proportional, it's equal and a fair system. Thank you. This is
all right. Okay, we're going to get into the question and answer period now. All right, we're getting into the question and answer period now, and I just want to remind everybody that keep your questions brief, and your question must end with a question mark. Oh, and one other thing that I forgot to say, one other thing I forgot to mention before we begin, is I would like to ask everybody to please silence their cell phones. You need to turn your cell phone off, or set it to vibrate, or mute, or mute so it doesn't ring. But the cell phones are disruptive too, like people talking. So please. Please silence your cell phones. Now, who's got a question? Go, raise your hand. Tim, go ahead.
All right, Li-Ping, I have a question for you. You know, what you've described with weighted voting and more interest is, in a sense, what a lot of other countries do through the prime ministership and multi-party democracy. What's the difference between your system and one that's already been useful, like in Britain or in Australia or in most other countries, where they have a prime minister and the party's got to coalesce and that kind of thing? How does yours differ from that? And I know there's a lot of stuff, but I mean, just adding these two components, basically what you're doing is kind of reinventing the wheel and all, in a sense, making a multi-party democracy.
Yeah, I think the major difference is 200 years ago, when you build a big room for assembly meeting, the room can probably only hold 100 people, 200 people, maybe like the U.S. House, it's 400 people or 500 people. That's the limitation of how many representatives you can hold to have a meeting. But my proposal is thousands of representatives is not a problem, okay? And so it can channel through all different opinions. Now the internet age, there are lots more opinions can be channeled through thousands or tens of thousands of representatives into the system, and it's a so people's opinion, no matter how different, for example, Tim is an environmentalist, he likes to reduce the carbon dioxide and all makes things clean, but he likes the nuclear power. Probably not many environmentalists are doing that, or not many people doing that, and you just couldn't find a candidate agree with you unless you make your own a candidate. So, but in this system, your voice will be carried to every bill. And the European multi-party system or parliament system, right now, still one representative vote one, and they are representatively equal. All the representatives are equal. Their one vote is one vote, okay? You just count one vote. It's not weighted by the election vote you receive. My system can handle lots of people, lots of representatives, and it's proportionally weighted by their vote, so it can, the voter got equal representing at the system.
Okay, Charlie, do you have a question?
Yeah, Lane, you want all this online voting, but it just was showed that everywhere they had electronic voting, Hillary won the primary, and where they had prime old-fashioned hard copy ballots, Bernie won the primary. That doesn't speak very well for your online voting. What do you mean? It can just be fixed? Well, yeah, it can be fixed, all right. Okay. This is so simply corruptible.
I think the reason is different. Hillary and Bernie's differences is Bernie's is wins caucus meeting. Okay, caucus has more discussion. Is more it's a real meeting. Okay, and I do want to promote that with the online capabilities. For Hillary's wins, those are regular voting, which does not involve much of the discussion, okay? And there's no, it's just based on the news, okay? Or if you go to Hillary's talk and listen or something, there's no good discussion. Online, right now, the online discussion is very, getting more and more popular.
All right, ma'am, did you have a question?
Yeah, so, Amito, your discussion was very idealistic, but the thing that concerns me is that once a person gets in office, there's no recourse. I mean, there's no accountability that they have to really represent the people that elected them. And, I think that the big problem with what we have in this country today is that we've got a duality. We've got people who are above the law and people who are down here struggling. And there is no way we can get rid.
Ma'am, what was your question?
That you fail to consider the fact that there's no accountability.
Question. Excuse me, ma'am, that's not a question, it's a critique. You could say that in the rebuttal speech.
How do you keep people we represent from corrupting us?
Okay, that's only possible with the track record. Okay, if you are really saying I'm an environmentalist, and then the only way, according to right now the system, because our system is not direct democracy, which you can really do that, still representative. And the only way is to see what the track record you have, and then people can follow that and see whether you say you did what you said. Okay. And right now, you can say that on different topics, my opinion is this, my proposal is that, and then people will compare to what you really, it's easier to compare that to what you did in the assembly meeting. In the past, it's all mixed up. You just left and right. But right now, you have various kinds of candidates.
All right, Doug Bashir, you had your hand up before. Did you have a question? Go ahead.
Yeah, I'm sort of fascinated by your allocation. And, you know, we just recently had the Republican primary, and we had like 16 candidates. We have just about a candidate for every type of voter. So, I don't know, are you saying that, we could have 16 candidates for president running the country, and they would get allocated votes according to the way they were voted for?
No, my solution is not applied to executive office. I think we always need a single one representative for the whole, say, country or whole state, and that's unavoidable. And you can only elect one. But for legislature system, we can do a better job than that.
All right. I would just like to say again that the Q&A session is a time for questions, not speeches. We have a rebuttal period for speeches. Okay, Andy, you had your hand up.
Point of order. If someone says something and they ask the speaker to comment on that, though, it is, in a sense, a question of what are your thoughts on that topic. So it's in the eye of the beholder.
Okay. Well, we don't use Robert's rules of order here. It's not Congress. Go ahead, Andy.
They use Robert's rules.
I have a follow-up to follow up Charlie's question. The critical problem we have today is we have many criminals running our electronic voting machines. how, the question to you is, how do we get from where we are to having honest people running all the online voting machines that you're talking about? What can be done? What can we do to move into honest control of the online and online voting that you're talking about?
Yeah, online voting machine right now, the problem is for secret ballots. Okay. Like during the election, our ballots are secret ballots. That caused all the problem for online voting. But for representatives, when they vote, their vote is not secret. Should not be secret at all. Okay. They vote can be publicized, and it should be publicized, and they themselves should verify their own vote on the, say, website or physically or whatever. And the once the verification is done, then all the tallies or add numbers together, that's a tribute, and they shouldn't be corrupted.
I guess what I'm asking is, millions of people are voting online, like you're talking about. How do we know that our votes are being counted from one candidate or another? Now, who's going to be running the controlling?
The election votes still stays like today. There's no change. There's no change for general election. Okay, that's a totally different topic. I can propose an online general election, but that's not today.
All right. Gene, did you have a question?
Yes. What is the name of the U.S. rep in the district that you live in? And have you written to them or emailed them or discussed with them personally or ask them to put in a bill to make your ideas law?
No. This place is the first place, the only place I'm sharing my thoughts.
Thank you.
Okay. And in terms of my own district representatives, it's an embarrassed point. I went to a Dick Durbin's meeting or election, and my district representative is there, but I know the name, but I couldn't put the name and face together. And then I met him and I asked his name. He saw, I thought, I forgot to put my name tag. I said, he didn't put his name tag.
All right, thank you. Okay, sir, did you have a question?
Yeah, I wonder if your ideas are actually leaning in favor of participatory democracy as opposed to representative democracy that we have today. With the participatory democracy, there will be no gerrymandering, and I think the purchasing power of votes will not be there either if there was more participatory democracy.
Yeah, I'm not familiar with participatory democracy. Is that the direct democracy people mentioned?
Where the communities gather together, like you mentioned, some meetings, and they discuss and eventually vote for somebody that want to run in the elections. So much money for this campaign and that campaign, and that's a representative democracy.
I think right now I'm still under the representative democracy, because for a large number of people, for a country like U.S. or for a state or even for Chicago City, if you don't have a representative, it's really hard to do things. Then also every citizen have to spend so much time on every issues. So direct democracy is really time-consuming and put lots of burdens on all the citizens.
Okay.
All right, let me just, Charlie had his hand. Okay, Doug Binkley, go ahead.
Yeah, Lee, I wonder if you know about a system in Illinois that existed for electing state representatives up to, I believe, somewhere in the 80s, where there were, I don't remember the exact specifics of it, but each individual person had three votes, and they could apportion them if they wanted to, three for one candidate, or they could apportion two to one candidate, one to another, or three votes to three separate candidates, and there were at least three candidates running for that district, and this was across the state of Illinois. There were three, at least three, it might have been four candidates running on voting machines, I think, at that time. I'm not sure exactly. But it enabled the minority party, if there was a district that was primarily Republican, if there was one Democrat on the ballot, all the Democrats could pool their votes three to one to that candidate and get that candidate elected. There might be two Republicans elected, but one Democrat from that district, and vice versa if it was a vastly majority Democrat. That would reduce the effect of gerrymandering. So could you comment on that if you knew about that system, if that system would get any favor from you?
Yeah, I read some similar systems that can minimize the gerrymandering, but still cannot totally get rid of that. And that's also, that's gerrymandering just one of the things I want, this method can ignore, can fix. Also for, basically, for any other system, you elect limited number of representatives, then some of the boys will get lost. With what I'm proposing, the good thing is no boys will be lost. If there's no cutoff for the representatives, you can get as many representatives as you want, and there's no boys, no voters' voice will be lost. And yeah, I think that's the major difference.
Okay, now, is there anybody who has a question who has not already asked a question? No? All right, well, I had a question for you, Li-Ping. This is more of a question of clarification. According to what you said, you were talking about what I think the gentleman over here said, that it's proportional. I think, no, it was Andy actually called it proportional representation. Now, and you were saying that each person gets basic one vote plus a fraction of one based on the percentage of the popular vote they got when they ran. And so, as I understand it, in a real world scenario, the way this would work is if let's say if you had an election where there's three candidates, a Green, a Democrat, and a Republican, and the Green got 10%, the Democrat got 50%, Republican got 40%, then all three would go to the legislature from that district, and
yes.
and the Green would get 1.1 votes, the Democrat would get 1.5 votes, and the Republican would get 1.4 votes. Is that how it would work?
No. This is only for a fraction part, is only for like U.S. Senate, which is not based on the population to district. If district based on the population, then you just count weighted by the straight number of votes.
Oh.
Then not a fraction.
Okay.
The fraction is like U.S. But in your example, the how the U.S. Senate would work is for Green Party, they got 10% vote, so their vote will be 0.1.
Oh.
The Green Party is 0.1, Democrat is 50% is 0.5.
Oh.
And the Republican is 40% is 0.4. So
oh, okay.
0.4 plus 0.5 plus 0.1 is 1.
Oh, okay.
To the current one.
Okay. So in other words, okay, you would do this, so you would do that, the PR, proportional representation, only with the U.S. Senate and bodies that are currently set up to have a fixed number, regardless of population.
Right, right.
Oh, exactly. All right, Charlie, you had your hand up. Go ahead.
All right. There's about 2,000 at least pieces of legislation pending at any given time in the U.S. Congress, and I can see a full-time rep. It's hard to keep up with it. You got remote reps, and they're getting paid for each only for a vote's cast. So they don't have to really know what they're voting for. Yeah, but they'll collect the money. We're going to pay for all these jamokes, right? They're allegedly, they're not full-time people. They just come home at night and press the key, and we're going to send them money for doing so, right?
Well, if
this is your improvement, right?
Yes, if they are dedicated, they are part-time, but they want to work. And they want to get information and...
they want easy money.
not necessarily easy money. See how much work they want to put in. And if they do a bad job next year, probably they are their own support. And they probably get $1 for entire year, or if you think that's easy money. Other people, they got 10,000 votes. They got $10,000 a year. That's good money. Okay, so really depends how you want to build your reputation, because you have to build your reputation through probably a session through 4 years. You have a track record, and then you can say, 4 years ago, I proposing this, and I voted in this, and the people can Google, can say, for the same legislature, same bills, my opinion is this, and compared to what he vote. There's a track record, I think it's easier to compare if there's a software there.
Okay, Tim, do you have a question?
Yeah, why do we have to have elections in the first place? Why not just appoint a commission and run it like a corporation?
Corporation is like an elected executive without the legislators. Legislators, they make laws, and then the executive had to follow the law.
Wasn't the Nazi Party, though, the most efficiently run state?
Yeah, that's...
No.
Dictatorship is most efficient. That's how China is efficient right now. But I think we are not for business. Yes, there's a clear target, making money, be efficient to make money. That's for corporations, for companies. But for government, well, government, the purpose is not making money. Government purpose is hard to say. It changes. Sometimes economy is the most important. Next time, all the foreigners is attacking us, prepare for the war is most important. Next year, probably, foreign immigrations and the illegal immigration. Next time is maybe AIDS epidemic, and there's no clear purpose. So I think for government, there's no clear direction. So when you say efficiency, it's efficient for what? It's hard to say. So I don't value the government. Efficiency is the most important. It's just one of the things the government should do and do correctly.
Okay. All right, we're running out of time, but sir, go ahead. Your question?
Yeah.
Okay, go ahead.
What, in your opinion, is crony capitalism?
Yes. What is crony capitalism, in your opinion?
You know what it is.
I probably need some explanation what the crony
I just want to say, for those who have not heard this term before, that crony capitalism refers to and you can straighten me out here if I'm wrong, sir, but crony capitalism refers to capitalism where the cronies of the people in government get special favors. Is that what you mean by that?
Somewhat, yes. Okay. It's actually, basically, it's where the big companies gather together, and they will promoted a politician, make him elected, or they will send their lobbyists in and control them that way. That's what we are facing nowadays, crony capitalism.
All right.
Right, like the 1% is controlling the country.
Exactly.
Okay. All right. Now, actually, we are out of time for questions. So we're going to have to move into the rebuttal period now. So I would just like to get a show of hands. How many people want to give a rebuttal speech? Everybody wants to give a rebuttal speech? Raise your hand. And keep them hands up, y'all. All right, that's one, two, three. Tim doesn't have to have his hand up. Four, five, six, seven, and I'm going to count Charlie. So that's eight. And so that's eight people. What about, okay. So how many minutes, Tim? You're the one that you're smart about math more than me.
Oh, hang on, let me check the time.
Okay.
How many people?
Eight so far. Let's throw in nine just for good measure.
Let's do five.
Five
we
minutes
do, we
each.
We can do five.
Okay.
Let me get a timer cracked open here. We're gonna
get 5 minutes each. All right. Let's give it up for Li-Ping.
Thank you.
Okay, all right, have a seat.
Yeah. Huh. You should run for governor next time.
Okay.
Get your drive. Get your drive, Lee.
Thanks much to the speaker. My understanding is if this system is ever to go into effect, you probably have to go at the national level or state level through the Congress or the legislature. And you would probably start with your own representative, U.S. rep or state rep, or state senator or U.S. senator, probably, to do that. The second thing is just basic. And I know this is simple, but obviously everybody doesn't know this. You got a voter card.
Yeah.
And on the voter card are numbers. And if you call your election commission, they will tell you the name of your U.S.
Nobody else? Nobody else going up there?
Is anybody else? Look, all right.
Come on, Richie.
I'll go. All right, since nobody else is gonna speak, let me just give me a moment here to get my stuff together. All right, first of all right, this was a very interesting presentation tonight. I don't know how many of you, how many of you were paying attention?
Trying to hear what's going on.
Yeah.
I want to hear what you're saying.
Yeah, listen, how many of you were, okay, thank you, ma'am. How many of you were paying attention to what's been going on in Congress this week with the congressional sit-in? Okay, that's Jonathan and Doug. Okay, a few more hands. Okay, so people heard about it. Good. They apparently the Democrats in Congress felt that that was the only way they could get anything done or get the Republicans to listen to them. According to opinion polls in this country, you know, Li-Ping is right. Dissatisfaction with the legislature is running very high in this country, at somewhere around 90% with U.S. Congress, and it tends to, you know, and I don't know what the figures are for the state legislatures. I would imagine it varies from state to state, but dissatisfaction with our Congress is very high. John Adams said that one useless man is a disgrace, two useless men are a law firm, and three or more useless men are a Congress.
That's true.
So, now, wouldn't quite go as far as John Adams personally, but I would say I think there's been a change in this country. Now, in the old days, we've always had political parties in this country, ever since the days of George Washington. But in the old days, the parties tried to work, most of the time, the parties tried to work together and work out their differences, work out deals, because that was how you got things done. Nobody could get 100% of their way all the time, so there had to be give and take. Today, members of opposite parties refuse to negotiate with each other, and this makes legislation almost impossible. Okay. Now, I'm not going to say who started this process, who decided that the word compromise was a dirty word. I'm going to leave that for y'all to figure out for yourselves. But I will say this, that it has become, it is increasingly becoming a practice of both parties, both major parties in this country, to refuse to compromise with the other side on anything, to regard the other side not as just people who have different interests, but as enemies to be defeated.
Yeah.
And as a result, we have paralyzed legislature. We have paralyzed Congress. Our U.S. government can't get anything done in Washington. And here in Illinois, we have a paralyzed state legislature. Our state government can't get anything done either. That state government can't even pass a budget. Now, when the legislature doesn't work, people look for alternatives. And what we heard tonight was one person's idea on how to change the system, on how to reform the system. You'll hear a lot of other ideas from other people coming up with you know, who, when the system isn't working, people start looking for alternatives. Now, this has happened before. It's happened here and it's happened in other countries. The one time in American history that before our time that the dialogue broke down and there was a total failure to agree on anything was on the eve of the Civil War. Now, and there's been a time in other countries. I've been reading a book recently called The Nazi Seizure of Power by William Sheridan Allen. I highly recommend it to all of you. Go check it out from your library. In Germany under the Weimar Republic, which for those of you who aren't history buffs, that was the German Republic immediately preceding the Nazis. As the Nazis got bigger, they got the bigger share of Germany's legislature, they absolutely refused to budge on anything. They blocked all legislation, so nothing could be done. They refused to give on absolutely anything unless Hitler was made chancellor. And so finally, in the interest of just even getting a budget passed, the president of Germany caved in and appointed Hitler chancellor. And that, of course, I think you all know what happened after that. Now, I want to just say in response to what Tim's praise of the Nazis, that the Nazis were not... Well,
in trouble now.
Now the Nazis were not more efficient. Now, just to give you some idea, the Weimar Republic lasted 15 years, the Nazis lasted 12 years.
Okay? And in that 12 years, the Nazis were defeated, with Germany utterly destroyed, in a war that they started. I don't call that more efficient. Even on their own terms, they failed.
Your time is up.
All right, thanks everybody for coming. Thanks for showing up. I had to take the stage. It could have turned violent. We don't want that. No, thanks for showing up, everybody. That's it.
All right, I go.
All right.
And I'll gradually leave my. You know, one thing that we have to understand about America, we get the government that we deserve. I honestly think that the reason we're having so much electoral troubles is we don't get involved. We don't go to the polls. We're all stuck in our own individual lives and we don't take the time to vote. If we don't vote and we don't participate, we get candidates like Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton. We get the candidates we deserve. A lot of us guys don't participate in local politics because of the time commitment involved and the onerous process of doing things. And to be honest with you, I think if you're in there and you want to do well, it's going to be time, take some time and sacrifice out of your own life. I just met this morning with one of the village board members of the community where I live at in Algonquin, Illinois. It's a part-time job, he says. But he said that he used to work full-time before he even considered coming into local politics. He says he spends around 40 hours a week for a part-time salary just to get the issues involved. Things like roads and buildings. He's on the zoning commission. And he said he spent 5 hours the other day trying to get somebody to approve a sign of all things on their business. They wanted to increase it by a foot. And they had to amend the local ordinance to do so. And to get the required committee approvals and everything else. He said it took him a 5-hour meeting on the one issue alone. The thing of the matter is the business of government in a lot of cases is very boring, it's very drudgery, it's a lot of numbers, it's a lot of things. And it can be a very onerous task. You have to be up for it, and you have to get involved. What can you do? Get involved. For example, with me in my local politics in Algonquin, you know, we have a local issue out there right now where they're, Algonquin, for example, has needed a third bridge for about 40 or 50 years for, you know, just a relief of traffic congestion. There have been many ways of doing it and going through it, but we have a big political stanchion by the name of Barrington Hills, which is one of the richest communities in the U.S. There's a few gentlemen farmers out there who quote-unquote want to keep the rural part of Barrington rural. But what they don't understand is that there's a big major two-lane highway that should have been four-lane maybe 30 years ago. Well, I think that's finally going to be coming because one of the biggest opponents to it has recently died and he donated his money to the Cook County Forest Preserve District. And now the biggest political entity along that certain stretch of road is the Cook County Forest Preserve District. And there are plans in place to finally four-lane this road. But it's taken about 30 years. There's also another proposal with the third bridge going in called the Long Meadow Toll Bridge. They're building it through bonds. They're going to be using an I-pass to, and it's just a road that you're going to have to pay like 50 cents to cross. The reason they're doing this is because they could not get money from the state to finish building it. But again, it took almost 16 years to finally get the votes and the approval in there. And you're going over a lot of some of the areas that have been designated as
Forest Preserve District for Cook, Kane, and McHenry counties. So they had to get the permits to cross that. But the point of the matter is, once this road is built, it's going to make a major change in my life by the amount of reduction time of maybe from a 20-minute drive for a 6-mile stretch down to maybe more reasonable 6 or 7 minutes. Does it mean a lot? Yes, it does. It means that I'll be able to move a little faster getting to work, as well as a lot of other people in McHenry County. The same thing was also true in Algonquin with its congestion. They recently completed a $10 million bypass around the downtown area. But it, too, took another 8 years to get the funding and complete. No, government is. We need to get involved.
Oh,
we need to get going.
Time is up. Okay, any more victims?
Okay.
All right. Here comes Doug Bashir.
No.
Oh, wait a second.
I'm going to washroom.
Okay. All right. Wait. Time out. Does anybody else wish to give a rebuttal speech? All right. Let's just one person. We got to have someone who hasn't given a rebuttal already. Anyone who hasn't given a rebuttal wants to come up here and. No? All right. Well, if nobody wants to give a rebuttal, then we must let Li-Ping have his say. And Li, Li-Ping, you get until 8:45.
Hope I don't need
that. So you got 11. You can go for 11 minutes.
Is anybody going near the L? I need a ride.
I'll give you a ride, Charlie.
Okay. I'll ferry you.
Hope I don't need that long. And thank you, everybody. Give me some feedback. And some parts, maybe I didn't make it clear. I think there are two kinds of votes. One is election votes. Now everybody participates. Those election votes will not change at all from this what I proposed. So if you worry about, say, in the election votes, some security or some very difficult to understand, that's basically nothing changed. Okay, for a regular voter, there's nothing changed. The only change is for us representatives. Okay, if you have a hard time to understand this, then you probably don't want to be a representative. Okay. This part of the voting is in the assembly meeting. Okay, all the representatives, they have a meeting and the voting for bills and for other things. Then that's changed. Basically, the idea is so that there are two kinds of voting. One is still for everybody. There's no change. Another is assembly, how to become a qualified representative is changed, and how they vote is changed. So I hope this is not too complicated, but just what I explained didn't sufficiently make it easier for people. And for Charlie's concerned about the representative, that they need to be professional, they need to be full-time. Yeah, I do agree the representative needs to be knowledgeable, but they should have a easy starting point. Okay, if they want to get into at a minor way, they can get into a minor way that, then this system is perfect for that. After they accumulate certain credentials and certain experiences, then they can do a big way and the people will vote for them more. I think in any of the system, credential is important. Right now, not many people look at that because what they did 4 years before is got forgot, and what they promised, nobody keep track. But because people just have only two parties, okay, one against the other, people lost the tracking of individual issues. So this system will force people to look at more detailed individual people issues for every candidate. Okay, because there are more candidates and there are more variations, not just two parties. So it's more work for citizens, more work for voters, but I think that's healthy and worthwhile. If it's capitalism or socialism or we need a more efficient government or more thorough government, that's a second issue. What I'm proposing is the process. Okay, if you are a candidate want to go for efficient government efficiency, then you can probably run for a representative and then introduce some bills to cut all the bureaucracy to make the government efficient. Okay. So if you want the government to be more socialism and take care of everybody, the poor and the disadvantages, yeah, you can go try to be a representative and voice your concern and go into the legislature to work on that. Or you can vote for some candidate truly, you think they are truly agree with you for that. Okay, so that's what my thought is. I'm more a person to think about things, but I don't know what to do, what to proceed. Maybe like Jim said, I should call my representative and give him some ideas. And yeah, that's. But if you have some ideas how to proceed from now, or let me know. Thank you.
Dismiss us. Dismiss us.
Okay, well, thank you very much.
And gavel us out, Don.
What?
Gavel us out and dismiss us.
All right. All right. All right. Class dismissed, y'all.